crazy. We were very proud to see John Sanders off to our Steve on his 11th surfing navigation. In a few months' time, we'll have a lady here who is the oldest woman to sail single-handedly around the world. That'll be happening in April. And now it's my great pleasure to welcome Heather Taylor, who's going to be first woman and West Australian to row halfway across the Pacific. I've seen in a short film festival, a short film that was made about the teams of four doing it across the Atlantic. And I thought, yeah, you'd have to be certified while I say this. I stand by that, so I'm going to hand over to Heather. And Heather will in turn hand over to her coach, Cameron, who will be sharing with us how you actually get somebody mentally ready to do this. So Heather and then Cameron, over to you. Once again, welcome.
Thank you very much for the introduction. And that film festival film is actually the one that first introduced me to ocean rowing. So at the first film festival 3 years ago, I saw a film about four women in, I think, probably 40s, 50s. There were four mums in a boat was how they pitched their story. Never rowed in their lives. And then 3 years later, they hopped in the boat and rowed across the Atlantic in the Atlantic race. And that was the first time I knew that you could row across an ocean. So how did you get here, I guess, is one of my big questions. That film was the one that sort of prompted my thought a bit, because I had rowed in high school, well, the last year of high school and a couple of years in university. And I think as a sport, it's something that I really love the motion of and enjoy it. And then, so I always had rowing as a thing, and then the ocean rowing was like, ooh, that'd be kind of cool. And then a few months later, I read another article about someone who'd done it and started to research it, posted online to see if anyone would like to do it with me. I had one friend on board for a few months, and that kind of rebooted up, and then it collapsed, people there. And then about 10 months went by, and the idea just kept on digging in and digging in. And I was able to convince another friend to come along on the journey, and she had to pull out for personal reasons. And by that stage, I was like, I'm just going to keep going. So that's how you end up doing it. So just keep going. Not by choice. Partially by choice, but you kind of end up at that point. Because I remember first looking at the race, and you went on to be the solo, this is for the Atlantic race, the solo rowers, and you went, well, these are special people. I could never be one of them. So we'll see at the end of it if I actually can. So this is the trip that I'll be taking, going 4,000 miles, sorry, kilometres. So that's basically from Perth to Sydney, rowing across Australia. So ocean rowing as a whole, if you haven't come across it, there have been 858 attempts to row an ocean, and of those, 544 have been completed. So you've got about a 66% success rate of finishing it, and about 1,000 people have successfully done it, and then there's 70 who've just loved it and gone nuts and done lots of things. And in terms of lost at sea, so it's not as though all the attempts have been ending in death, but there's been 9 rows that have been lost at sea. So comparatively, if you look at other ambitious feats, so there's about 9,000 successful climbs of Everest, and you actually have a higher mortality rate climbing Everest, which is not surprising actually, just because of the cold factor. And then there's less people that are in the space as well. So I've got about 500 space walkers. So in terms of the California to Hawaii route, there's actually only been 5 successful solo rows across this route. More than 10, as you start to network a bit more, you find out, oh, they tried to, oh, they tried to. Comparatively, if you look at the Atlantic, you have a lot more successful rows, and that's largely to do with currents, which I'll show you in the next slide. So of those who have done it, the fastest person was 52 days, and the slowest was 111. And my competitor, of course, but the only other female who's been able to successfully cross it in 91 days. So if I can do it in less than that, I'll get that record. But I'm just aiming to complete it, largely. So the reason that it ends up being quite difficult is for those who've looked at sailing charts, but basically you have the green lines are the ones that have current. So imagine that's the flow of the ocean. And if you look at the coastline, current's coming down from the north and it goes there. And then also, these are wind rosettes. So the winds here are quite strong, pushing you that way, but also pushing you into shore. So for this little bit here, when I say little, that's like 400 miles, you're basically going, you're being pulled south and sort of pushed inland. So you're basically being pushed into the land. And if you didn't have a sea anchor, you'd end up in Mexico, which is what happened to one guy who did it. So there's a lot more success if you're doing it in pairs or fours, but as a solo row, you just don't actually have enough force or energy to do it. So this stretch is actually going to be the most difficult part. So the first 2 weeks is kind of, if you make that, then you're probably going to make it. And if you don't, then, well, like everyone else, you can make it. So that's sitting in the back of my mind going. So just see how we go. I'm going to wait for a good weather window and sort of plan to slowly chip my way out as I go. So it will actually be quite a challenge to achieve it. And then if it doesn't work out, I can always hop in the Atlantic and just coast to coast. So that's the challenge as it sits. So it is actually going to be quite difficult. I think the more time I spend in the boat, the more you realise that it's going to be hard. But this is the boat. So if you do have a chance afterwards, you can wander it. It's just being by the, what do you call that area?
The dinghy
launch area.
Okay, so the ramps just
have... Yes, yeah, just by the boat ramps, you can have a look at the boat that's there. So this is the boat. It was built in 2014 by two rowers who rowed it from New York to England. And it's been through a hurricane, so they went through a hurricane on their trip. So I feel comforted to know that I think they had one fixing that fell off on the outside. So the boat's quite solid. And I've been out in pretty rough weather already, so sort of 30 knots, I think, it peaked one night. And it handles really well, it just kind of floats and bobs. Very noisy inside. And the second row is actually one from California to Hawaii, and that again was two rowers that took that across. So it's got your usual fixing in it. It's got a GPS plotter, a VHF radio, and automatic identification system for those who are not boat people. That's the thing that basically sends out a signal saying, I'm here, don't hit me. So, and you can watch it on the chart plotter and you can see two boats coming along. And even when you're not going to hit, it still comes up with this like shipwreck symbol. So it's coming, it's like in 8 minutes, and it, like, the alarm goes off and you have to get up and look out and see what's happening. So I saw a cruise ship on Sunday night, and that came through, and I probably got within a kilometre of it. The issue with the rowing boat is that I don't have much control over where I'm going if it's quite windy, so I'm sort of at the whim of the wind, so I have to see where the wind's going. Okay, well, that's going to be where I'm going to be, and hopefully the boat goes around me. So that's a bit different than if you have a motor or a sail. There's three solar panels that are providing all the power. I do have a radar enhancer which makes my signal appear stronger. Got speakers, so I have music for audiobooks, and a desalinator on board. And so this is the inside of the cabin. It's actually, you can have two people sleep in it. So these straps here are, if I need to strap down and it's getting really, really rough and the boat's likely to capsize, I can at least strap myself to that so I'm not banging around. And so it has a space to have two people in it. So my sister and I had a sleepover in it one night. And it's fairly spacious, and then you've got your instruments here. And this is the desalinator, which just sits on the side, and then you've got the netting and stuff, and the hatches below. I can also store some things in it as well. So that's the boat itself and the trip. And I'm going to introduce to you Cameron. So when I started doing this and sort of investigating what it is that you can do, someone mentioned, oh, you probably need to get in touch with a sports psychologist, because how are you going to handle it mentally? So I emailed lots of sports psychologists around, and Cameron was the kindest and emailed me, replied to me, and said, I'd love to work with you. So he's come on board as a sponsor. He's worked with, I don't know, Olympians and world champions, and he's taken me on as a pretty much a novice rower, and working with me to do that. So I'll invite you to come up without further ado and walk through something that we've been going over through.
Absolutely. It only took me about 2 years to pronounce it properly. What do you think of it?
Tringali.
It goes by two names. One's Csikszentmihalyi, and the other one's Csikszentmihalyi, which a lot of students prefer the second one because it's easier to remember. As you have probably guessed with this amazing trip Heather's about to do, there's a huge amount of preparation, sacrifice, and everything that goes into it. You don't just sort of wing this type of trip. You have to commit, every single part of your body, soul, and mind towards the trip. And something Heather is going through. And my job, I work with athletes, executives, performers, and so forth. But generally, my job is to kind of help people become an elite professional, be able to perform under pressure, and be able to execute their decision making in the best possible manner. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about the types of things that would go into the preparation for this trip, a little bit about the science of how people make decisions under pressure, and then I'm sure you guys have some questions for Hazel at the end of it, so we'll ask them to stop briefly after, and we can harass Heather with questions. When you're undertaking big events, this is a real consequence for a lot of extreme situations. We have these good ideas, and often we see these amazing pictures, and we see these amazing feats or achievements, but often what we miss out on is all the background stuff, all the stuff that actually happens for 99.8% of the time. And so, one of my jobs is to help people to do events, stop things like this happening, and definitely with Heather stopping things like this happening. And obviously the key thing to making sure that these performances happen as they're planned is getting an initial preparation going. And that goes from physical training, to logistics, to getting things shipped out, to a whole range of organizing work, organizing time to train in the river, going up and down. You just come back from Dunsborough, and you just rode all the way back from Dunsborough in the past couple of days. So there's a huge amount, and if the preparation isn't there, everything kind of starts to fall down. And then once the preparation and the plan is sort of in place, I work a lot on the resilience. So during times of stress, during times where the going gets tough, how do we stay in a place of resilience, and rather than allowing motivations to wane, rather than allowing emotions to pop up and persuade us in other ways that we don't want, which all affects our decision-making in the moment, which is absolutely critical. When Heather's going to be out there rowing 12, 13, sometimes longer hours every single day, there's going to be physical exhaustion. And how do we maintain really good decision-making when the whole mind and body is just wanting to wave the white flag, is exhausted, and wants to do everything else but do the one thing that the individual's got to do. And ultimately, all of this affects the overall performance. So I just want to give you guys a little, taster of what people in extreme situations might feel like. So we're going to put down the pints for a little bit, and together I'm going to ask you guys to hold your breath. Okay? And we're going to breathe in the second. We're going to breathe in together, then we're going to breathe out together, and then we're going to hold our breath. And as we hold our breath, I just want you guys to become aware of your experience. Notice how your experience is now, whether it's fun, whether it's easy, whether the breathing's nice and gentle. And then when we hold our breath, I just want you to observe what your experience is like when you start to get signals of pressure, when your body starts to give you signals of stress. All right, you ready? So we're going to breathe in together. You ready? Breathe out together and hold your breath. Hand up if you're still holding your breath. And just notice what your mind starts to do. How that might affect your decision making. When your body starts to fail you, when your body starts to say stop, breathe, no more, can your mind still continue past it? And at those critical points when you get really, really, really stressed, can you find that release valve and that edge again? There's always a couple of free divers in here. Okay, we're going to stop there for anyone who's still going. You know, and the point being is that when the pressure starts to happen, we start to operate in a slightly different way. We start to operate in a way that isn't how we plan, how we prepared, how we want to particularly act. But, you know, all you guys, if we were to take an oxygen test of your blood, then we probably would have got some 96 to 98%. You know, in hospitals where you start administering oxygen, it's way below that. You could have held your breath, in theory, practically, for minutes before you actually needed to breathe. But the mind persuaded us that we needed to breathe. Our mind persuaded us, we've got to breathe now. And it might have even felt pressure build up in your head or pressure build up in your chest. But ordinarily, you know, you don't have to breathe. Even when your chest starts compressing, you've still got loads of oxygen inside. You don't need to breathe. But we create these narratives, we create these stories, we create this pressure, this sort of internal stress that goes on along inside us. And all of that mildly either in an intense situation, you know, such as this one, or as Heather's going to be experiencing over a long period of drawn out time, the mind and body is starting to react in ways that take us away from that kind of optimal position in how we want to be operating. So, you know, when we look at from a scientific point of view, what's the difference between, you know, this particular experience and this particular experience? In this particular experience where things are maybe a bit hazy, we've obviously still got the courage and the impetus to go out in that insane wave, but it doesn't, it just doesn't feel right. So this experience, same wave, you know, not too different a time, but everything's a bit more crystal clear. We find that opening, we don't stumble, we're able to execute in that moment to moment how we wanted to, how we planned. So what I spend my life sort of asking myself, researching and writing about and talking about and working with other people about, is what is optimal experience? What's the difference? What, you know, why do in certain moments do we perform where everything's crystal clear, and why do other ways do we stumble and trip? And from a scientific perspective, they've come up with this term called flow. This scientific term which exemplifies those moments where we act with a sense of effortlessness to what we're doing. When the whole world us around kind of melts away, you know, when you've been so absorbed in a particular task and you kind of come out of it, you go, well, time has just flown by. And you go, oh, that was interesting. Well, those moments where you're deeply in play, or you're deeply in an email, or you're writing something, or you're off in the ocean and you're doing whatever you're doing, and then suddenly you become so absorbed in the moment, you forget everything else around you. And everything that you do seems easier, freer, and so forth. And when we have a look at that experience and we kind of go, hang on, that's just not luck. That's just not just a random experience. What actually happens here on a moment-to-moment basis, on a physiological basis, and from a neuroscientific basis, and a psychological basis, what actually happens here, and what we're able to identify, is that, okay, those states are actually a very different state than we normally get to when we're under stress or under pressure. You know, just some basic research here. The McKinsey and Company Global Research Institute did a study and found that executives would self-report themselves to be 5 times more productive in a state the US Air Force are doing some interesting studies with transcranial direct stimulation, and where they're mimicking it by overstimulating some parts of the brain, and they're getting at least a twofold improvement in learning. But really importantly, to kind of understand what flow is, and then after we've understood what it is, we can then reverse engineer it. We've got to separate it from what we normally want to associate. We normally associate it with things like performance, where we can still lose, but be having the best optimal functioning that we've ever done. We've all played a sport and been against someone who's much better than us, but played the best sport that we've ever played, so forth. Or we played the best riff we've ever done just at home in our own lounge. And equally, these moments are very different from peak experiences where we might be feeling exceptionally high or great, but not applying ourselves in the optimal manner. And most importantly, and this is the real key when I'm working with individuals, is we often notice these moments when we have like a big event or we've built up to something. And we kind of think, okay, yeah, this might happen once a week or once a month or once in a lifetime maybe. But actually, we're all experiencing these moments every day. And when I work with people, what we do is we start to recognize these kind of micro meta states of flow. We start to notice that actually they're popping up all the time, but we never show them any notice. And if we can manage our states and sort of engineer that as we go about everything that we do, then when we need them most, we're well trained for it to happen. So from an academic point of view, there's sort of three main dimensions, if you like, to this experience. The first one is that there's this absorption into the task that differentiates it from concentrated action or play or other forms, where we're this focused attention and we become sort of action and awareness merge and the normal, what is everyone thinking of me or what do I look like? All those sorts of feelings just disappear. Second is that there's a effortlessness to what we're doing, there's an ease to our actions. We've all been challenged, we all hopefully get challenged every single day and haven't put ourselves in a corner of comfort. But there'll be those times where we kind of just feel like we're forcing things, sometimes where the challenge just feels like we're trying a little bit too much and it just feels a bit clunky. But these times, there's other times where things feel a lot effortless. And lastly, there's a rewarding, intrinsic rewardingness to the experience that allows it to happen from an arousal and balance point of view that continues it. So I'm going to ask you guys just to speak to the person next to you and think about when you might have been challenged in the past and where instead of feeling that usual grit or that kind of pushing on, I'm going to make it happen, you've just found a slight ease to the experience, a slightly different experience than you've had before. So we're going to have 2 minutes, so team up with one other person and just see if you can identify any of those experiences in your life. Okay, could anyone identify with those experiences where things have become easier? Any hands? Yeah. Do you want to share one briefly?
So there's been occasions when I'm writing a biography of my grandfather. So I'm writing a biography of my grandfather. I'm in year 20 now, desperately wanting to get published. But there have been occasions where I've just sat down and I've written a paragraph or two and it's just flowed out. Doesn't need that. Not because of ego, but because of that least that one paragraph is good.
Yeah, you know, often, you know, we get writer's block and then there comes that period where... So how do we, you know, certainly what I'm obsessed and fascinated about is how do we reach those moments when we really want them? Because often they're even more elusive when we really, really want them. They can come randomly or at certain times. And often when we look at, you know, how is the brain wired to act in a particular challenge, and I'll go into some of it a little bit later, but where the brain is instinctively wired to kind of act like a chimp, right?
Perfect practice.
Perfect practice can help to a point. Yeah, and deep practice can help to a point. And they can build neurological pathways in a basal ganglia, and they can create that automation. But it doesn't help, doesn't determine whether we reproduce that in any given moment.
I think insight, that's the perfect physical practice, but then I think you gain insight from repetition like that. I think that helps the mental side of it when you have insight into the situation. So I'll link the two together.
Yep. Yeah, we certainly, through that path of mastery, we get that insight and we get that desire to reproduce that. But typically what happens when we face a challenge is our amygdala, we've got this limbic system that sits at the top of our spine that kind of fires an alarm, it's like an alarm. And then our prefrontal cortex is kind of like a firefighter to that alarm, and it wants to jump in and it wants to help and it wants to sort it out. And it starts to think about it and goes, okay, well, how do I want to react? What should I look like? Where should I go? How should I react? And in doing so, it kind of slows our thinking, our decision making down. Slows it down to a point where instead of acting fluently, we kind of get this sort of mild fight, flight, and freeze. We kind of want to avoid the situation, or we push it away, or we do any number of things as opposed to acting fluently. And one premise around flow is that when we are optimally challenged, instead of sort of staying in this control zone, which most of us face a challenge with, where things are kind of in our control and we're just at the top of it and we've got it, or for other people where we get a bit over aroused and we get anxious, we're able just to kind of play with those edges and just find a slightly different space. And what we've been able to find is that from a neurophysiological point of view, I'm not going to go too into these, but there's some very distinct differences to what happens in the mind and body. The first is that our heart rate becomes coherent. So our heart rate can go through the roof, we can be jumping off a cliff, but there's still a level of coherence to the heart rate. And this you see in sort of heart monitors going all the time, and when there's stress in an extreme expedition, you know, we get these reactions, whether it's how am I going to make dinner tonight? How am I going to go to the toilet? Which way should I go? How hard should I grow? All these decisions can be made either through this mode or it can be made through that mode, where the heart's a little bit more coherent and it says our nervous system is a bit more balanced. This synchronization theory is that when we're in this state of effortlessness, certain parts of the brain start to sync up. So the attentional parts that are focused towards the task-oriented activities start to sync up with reward networks. And we're able to get rid of this kind of conscious control of what we would normally have over a particular experience. And lastly, there's this part of our brain called the ACC that's constantly monitoring effort and going, is there a conflict? Is there a conflict? Is there a conflict? And when there is a conflict, we turn attention inwards to sort of sort it out. And that puts effort into our system. But when we're in these effortless states of flow, that activity subsides to almost nothing. So there's a very different scenario that's happening in the brain. So practically, I told you a little bit about science there, but practically how do we sort of work our way into that zone? Well, typically if this yellow zone is where we want to sort of end up, there's often this experience that comes either side when we're not in that zone. So in this sort of, maybe everyone's seen a bell curve of performance when so that the performance starts to rise, we reach this optimal performance, and then performance starts to decrease. And typically, if there's a very high effect, like, I'm over the moon, this amazing thing happened to me, and then we've knocked something over and we've dropped our mobile phone, our sort of performance is not very good. And equally, if we're super nervous and super anxious, our performance starts to die down as well. And often when we're in these scenarios here, there's this, the world is happening to me. But when we're in this more sort of empowered zone, there's this feeling of, things are happening by me, I'm making this happen. But when we're in this more effortless, optimal state of functioning, we get to a stage where things are happening through us. And then from a behavioral level, our reactions, how do we behave, how do we respond? When we're over here, we're often reacting. When we're in this zone, we're often responding. And when we're in this zone, we're often acting. When we're over here, we're very, very anxious. And when we're over here, we become avoidant. Here, we're very resilient. So how do we, you know, how do we, ideally we want to be here, but often we don't know where we are. If a performer's got a really big event, or if we've been training for a long period of time, or we've put a lot of energy into events, we're just caught up in it. And as people, as individuals, as participants, as coaches, the rest of it, we're often caught up in the experience and never checking in to actually where we are. What we've noticed is that if we are over here, it's almost impossible to get back into this phase or this phase by simply just saying, oh, come on, pull your socks up, I'm better than this. Come on, I'm going to make this happen. We've like physiologically gone down a rabbit hole, but we cannot get back into this stage unless we reset, unless we have a particular reset. We, you know, we jump up and down like a chicken, we slap ourselves in the face, we put cold water up down our neck, something that physiologically and mentally kind of shock our system to get back in. And then from this scenario, then we can start using the normal mental skills, focusing and mindfulness and resilience and so forth to help us get back into that very focused and effortless state. You know, one of the most important things, I guess this is like a practical model to help us recognize when we're out so we can self-regulate to get back in, is learning to do this in very day-to-day mundane situations. So then when particular challenges come up, public speaking, presentation, doing an event, I've been rowing for 13 hours and completely exhausted and I've got to figure out which meal to cook and so forth, how can we actually manage our state so then we can make decent decisions and then we don't overuse food and leave ourselves short and the whole expedition goes to pot and so forth. So typically when we work with someone, we look at, okay, what happens before the event and during the event, and typically most of us have this sort of turmoil preparation where we get a little bit anxious, we start to lose energy, we become highly stressed, and then finding this kind of optimal state is pretty much near impossible. But if we do prioritize our experience, and this is the one, I guess, main key takeaway I wanted to put across today, if we do prioritize the quality of our experience first and foremost, and it's a very different experience than what most of us are used to, which is this kind of gritted, force it, I have to make it happen scenario, which gets us only so far. We can do great things with it, but we never find this sort of optimal experience where if we do manage what we're doing and we're seeking out that effortless experience, then we can lead our preparation into finding flow. And just a quick example to leave us on, you know, this lady I worked with, Lorraine Hoover, was a world-class skier for 12 years, always coming top 10 in the world, and doing well, but never quite reaching the heights that she thought she might be able to do one day. And so we started to work on, okay, how do we find this state of effortlessness? How do we find these optimal experiences? Because she'd been so drilled to kind of just make it happen, force it happen, and it got her to, you know, top 10 in the world, but it never got her onto that podium. But when she was able just to make that tiny switch, it's a real simple switch, and it sounds ridiculously simple and easy. But doing that, and being consciously aware of that when we're under pressure, is a very, very different skill. She was able to get the results that she wanted. So I've hopefully given you a little insight into what elite performers and what people in extreme environments kind of need to be working on in the background. So when they get to those pressure cookers, they're able to manage their experience throughout it. And this not only comes in just big performances, this comes day to day when we're tired and having to have conversations with family members, and we've just been physically training our asses off for so long, or making a decision about how we do X, Y, and Z. It kind of applies to everything we do. So I hopefully give you a little bit of insight of what I do with other people. If people want to know more, we hold programs, and please come and speak to me afterwards. But most importantly, if anyone is in a position today to support Heather on this amazing trip that you're about to go under, we would love some support. There's all sorts of costs that goes into these kind of expeditions, and these are just some examples, from a sextant, child weather gear, an Android tablet, airline tickets, and shipping costs and so forth. If anyone is in a position to be able to help or fund out, or know someone that is, it would be greatly appreciated to make this trip happen. So thank you very much, and I'm going to pass it back over to you for why.
I learned some things tonight that I hadn't gone over with him before. So one of the big questions is why. I went into how it happened, I guess, as to how I came about with the idea. But in terms of why, I think the idea has sat with me, and I've kept on going, and still would keep on going because I can't think of a reason to stop. And that's basically the driver has been, I guess, my heart within it, of using the trip as a fundraising opportunity. So the goal of the trip is actually, as much as I need sponsorship, is actually to do fundraising for communities that are facing poverty. And this is something that has been, I guess, in part of my life for probably my whole life, coming with my parents' work, and just those that I know. So that's the big driver, is if people can stop and think, why on earth is she doing this? That would explain it. So I'm going to actually play a video which I think explains the heart of what, is the reason as to why.
I am not a number on a page.
I am not a crystal tomb of war.
I am not a Sunday project.
Or an opportunity for you to feel good.
I'm not a development goal.
A mission trip.
A Facebook status.
A gold coin donation.
Or a quick minute of your time.
My name is Pip T. I'm married with 3 children, and although we will never meet, we are connected.
Not too long ago, my life was very difficult. We had to depend on the rice fields alone for our livelihood. When the field would do poorly, we had to borrow money from a private lender to survive. Their interest rates are very high, and it made life very challenging. When I was younger, it was never as dry as it is now. Today, there is very little rain, and it makes the season less predictable. It makes it harder to farm. To try and increase yields, many people import seed and fertilizers. My family would often become sick from this food, especially my husband.
One day, a program leader from PNKS invited us to attend the Village Development Association. We wanted to learn about hygiene and growing our own vegetable to improve our health and livelihood, so we decided to join.
Since joining the VDA, there has been significant change in our life. I learned how to care better for our health and how to make better use of my land. We now have fish pond, chickens, pigs, a vegetable garden, and can collect our own seed for planting next season. We also learned about the harmful health effects caused by the pesticides and the damage they can cause to our land. The VDA has taught us how to produce our own fertilizers naturally, which not only saves us money, but it healthier. We not only have enough food for ourselves, but I now sell my vegetables at the local marketplace. They are very popular. People are tired of vegetables that are filled with harmful chemicals. It's exciting to see the change in our community. Others, like me, are also learning how to improve their livelihood.
My name is Yosaran, and this is my wife, Ong Kung. Before we joined the VDA, life had many hardships. I lost my leg from a landmine left over from the war and have only a small farm to manage. Because of my injury, earning a livelihood is very difficult. It is also hard to connect with people in my community. After joining the VDA, we learned how to make better use of our land through the vertical garden. We were also able to create a fish pond and provide chicken to have a livelihood. My neighbors are very interested in the skill I have learned and now visit me regularly. I am less lonely as a result and don't feel ashamed by my disability.
There are many others like us in our community that are learning to make a better life for themselves thanks to the techniques we are learning. Things are improving for us, yet we still have a long way to go. There are still a lot of people using harmful chemicals and costly farming practices that are poor and need help. My dream is to be able to have a larger farm so that my daughters can work the land with my husband and I. Like many families here, they currently work in the clothing factories. It's hard work. They do not have safe working conditions. She is often sick from the poor food they provide and tired from her long hours. My hope for tomorrow is to see my community happy and healthy. One of the main reasons I joined VDA was because of the importance they have in sharing, loving, and caring for others. As we are learning more and more, everything is connected, from the land and the way we care for it, to the ocean, and to the sky. We each play a part in caring for our planet and each other. My name is Beauty, and although we will never meet, we are connected.
So Tears Joy is one of the organizations that I'm partnering with in doing this row, along with Emmanuel International, which is Canadian and UK based. And so they do, both of them do quite similar work in the sense that they work locally with local churches or local organizations holistically. It's very people-centered, empowering and sustainable. So working through with the communities and often focusing on the most marginalized within a community. And both of them look at different areas, sort of the basic level education, health, water and sanitation. So these are a few of the projects that Tia has been running. Food and livelihood, emergency response, community building, so helping people work to improve their own lives and helping them recognize barriers and break them down. So in terms of funds given to, if you're wanting to get donate and have tax receipts, Tier Australia is probably the one that you would support if you're in Australia. And then there's two programs in particular that partnering with for Emmanuel International. And this is one that's in Malawi. It's called the Acholi Girls Fair for Your Future project. And basically it's working with girls who are coming into puberty and helping to provide them with long-term options for managing their period so they're actually able to still come to school and not drop out, and then the ongoing fallout of not having continuing with their education in that. That's a program that's in Uganda and Tanzania. That some of the girls receiving education, so they get four pads and underwear as well, and it just supports the local tailors as well. And then a project in Malawi is the Promise Project, and that's focusing on child and maternal health and improving that. So those are the three areas that we're looking towards and targeting, trying to get 250,000, which seems quite impossible, but to be honest, it is zero. So that's the goal of the row, really, in a nutshell. So if I can get to the end of that, and if we can able to raise that as I go, that would be, I think, what would make the trip for me. So that's all I really had to share tonight. So I think we wanted to open it up for any questions across the board. Yeah. Any questions?
How can you row these amazing distances and you don't seem to have any muscle?
I don't know, actually. I think I've tried to do weight training and I have a bit. I think I've probably fallen behind a bit on my physical training, if I'm honest. So in the last 4 days, so I left Dunsborough on Sunday and I arrived in Bandra at 1 p.m. today, so that's 4.5 days. And I probably would have been doing at least 8 hours of rowing a day. So this morning I was up at 4 and was rowing till 12 and, you know, start, kind of eat a granola bar and have to keep going because there's nothing else to do, keep rowing. So I feel like it's a different type of fitness. Yeah. So I think you can get big and bulky, but in the end it's just you have to keep going. So we'll see if I end up being bigger at the end of it. Oh, because you'd end up getting stuck. Actually, I'm just going to speak and go to it. You end up getting stuck. You could go the other way, but you kind of have to start in Japan to do that. So it's that's probably a bit far for me. So the only way to get, so this is just the Pacific here. So it comes around and it does a big sort of conveyor belt happening. So over here is Japan. So if you started here, you can come along and then eventually you'll hit any part of the coast and you'll have gone across. So some people have gone from Japan, probably five have made it, the whole way across the Pacific. And then the other option is to come from here and then you can end up also ending up going into Australia, or you can take the halfway mark and end up in Hawaii. It's just this particular part of the coast, the way that the winds are, it's quite difficult. So there isn't really a way to go from Hawaii up. You could maybe get stuck up in like a little circle and shoot, but then you might end up in Alaska, which would be very cold.
Yeah. Why that particular distance or that particular thing? Why not just row down to one river for the day? Why that particular distance?
Well, there's actually a race that they do in the Atlantic, and then there's one in the Pacific from California to Hawaii. So that's, I guess, one of the common routes that you can do. Yeah. So that the reason, I guess, is just it's a route that's rowable. So when you do start to look at where you could row, there's only certain places you can actually go. You could basically have to follow the trade winds, or you could go from sort of north coast US coastal back to England. So you have to follow the Gulf Stream and get in those same loops. Because the boat is controlled pretty much by the wind, I would say. Yeah, it controls all your direction, and the current is helpful. It's rarely a hindrance, but the wind is the dominant feature. Even in the Swan River, it destroys everything. So if you go out anything above 15 knots, you just can't control the direction of where you're going to go. So that's one of the reasons is that it is a nice route,
yeah.
Apart from the first part.
How are you going to manage the seasickness in that first
part? That's what I haven't quite figured out. So I have talked to a few people. So I've discovered that I get seasick for about the first 2 days, first about 6 hours before I have the first vomiting experience. And then from there, I'm kind of out for 2 days. Can't really do too much. I can row for a bit, then I can't get too far. So I need to figure out a way to sort of hold my ground and get through that. And I have spoken with someone as to whether that would actually be, would debilitate everything and then cut the trip. But I think I can probably have a day of leeway if I can get an anchor, whether it's the anchor, and at least hold a bit of distance and then slowly chip my way through it. So I can get past 48 hours, then I can keep going. Mm-hmm. So it was encouraging to know that I can probably lose a day not actually running and still make it.
Direction-wise, how can you keep on course? How do you actually do it as you're rowing? What are you looking at?
So I have a little GPS screen which has a bearing on it and a track. So every day there's a gentleman who's going to be providing me weather as well as a waypoint, whether or not he gives me one waypoint every 4 days, and I'm heading for that point. So I've got that in my GPS and it just tells me aim for that direction. So that's what I'm looking at and balancing to keep the boat heading in the right direction. So if the GPS goes, then I'll have to hold a compass to try and hold the bearing into it.
And if we want to track your position, could you advise us the best way of doing that?
Yes, the best way would be to go over to the website, and I'm going to have the tracker hopefully on the website, and then if not, it will have a link, and so you can actively track where I am at that point. So this last trip, if you were on the right page, you could see where every 4 hours it updates, so you can see the position.
You said this is a route that's selected because it's used for a race. Now, are you actually participating in that race so that you've got other people that you're sort of timing yourself against with progress and sort of support networks around it, or are you doing this as a solo?
I'm doing it as a solo because they don't allow solo rowers into the race. Yeah, so they had the experience, and I don't think many made it in the first one. The tricky part of being a part of a race is there is a bit of support, but after a couple of weeks you can see the boat spread out and you'll never see them. You're in the same race, but you won't see them or talk to them as much. And the problem with the race in this particular instance was that they had to start at that time, at that day, and the weather was just horrible, and yet that's the way the race started, so they had to go. So there's a lot more flexibility in doing it independently, is that if bad weather, you're just not going to go that day. You might as well wait another 3 days and go and actually succeed. And so in terms of the level of support, I wouldn't be getting necessarily any more from being in the race versus not being in that race. Yep.
How are you going with your plans for diet in the Pacific? Have you done a lot of planning towards that yet and getting the food stocks and things?
So I need to eat about 4,000 calories a day, which ends up being about 4 meals plus snacks. So I've got a food sponsor on board, so they're going to give me a discount to have dehydrated food, and then I'm just needing to create a giant spreadsheet to make sure I'm getting the right calories on board. So I have a small camping stove, and that's my main cooking. And other than that, I don't have a fridge, so it's basically camping on board with dehydrated food. So I think that's been the hardest thing thus far, is being out there and not really wanting to eat the food that I have, or you just want something so simple you open can and you can eat. So not wanting to stop and cook, and if the boat's it's too rocky, it's actually quite hard to cook. So needing to balance the practicality and when you just don't want to eat what you have, I think it's probably going to be the hardest part, just to force them in. Yeah.
Are you allowed any sort of outside intervention in terms of resupply of food or anything?
You could have it, but if you're going for an unsupported trip, you couldn't. So it's similar, I think, to unsupported sailing. You'd have to take everything that you have. So I'll take 4 months of food with me and all the supplies that I need. And if I do need support, I could get support, but then it takes away the unsupported portion of it.
Mm-hmm.
No. There is actually one documentary where they there were two Lithuanian rowers and they had a ship that dropped them a whole bag of potatoes and apples. That new documentary. Yeah.
How do you think you'll go with like spending that much time in your own head, and what sort of things do you have to keep yourself occupied apart from rowing for X numbers of hours a day?
Yeah, I found audiobooks are quite good. Yeah, so you kind of like live in like a little story. That's been the thing that I've been doing most. Music is good if you kind of need to jolt yourself out of the system and get excited for a bit, but it only lasts for so long, and then if you're in a story, you can kind of keep on going, and 5 hours can go by, and you haven't really noticed that 5 hours went by, whereas 5 hours of music is actually a lot of music. Or if you're chipping through podcasts, it's quite a lot. So I found audiobooks to be quite useful.
Certainly relate to your comment about audiobooks, because I drive 5 hours quite regularly with books. But what I wanted to say first is that declare my interest. I worked with Csikszentmihalyi some materials from 1978 before he was widely published, primarily from a sociological point of view. What I'm interested in is how these concepts work for you, and in a sense, why you wrote. Lots of different ways to do this, to get to those kinds of experiences that all this research is about, and which the experimental psychologists are involved with, including some of the ones there. But why do you row? Why do you row, and how does this relate to what you do and what you experience on the ocean?
I think when I get up, I rely on the fact that I made the decision that I have to row, so I'm going to row. I think that's probably when it comes down to, like today, I was rowing in and I had to get up at 4 in order to get in time, and the winds, I need to stop after 5 hours, and I don't want to do this anymore. But there's no other option. You just have to keep going. And so I think that's the thing, is like sitting there, there's nothing else to do, and you have to actually just keep going. So that's probably falling back on that, I've made that decision to row, therefore there I have to keep on going with it. That's probably how I've experienced that in a very practical sense. If you go, I could stop, but there's nothing else to do, I still have to get to the point where I need to. Does that answer
your question? That's partly about motivation.
Yeah.
But what does the analysis that we heard from Cameron, I think it is, how does that relate to what you do? And how does that relate to why you row?
Mm-hmm.
Not that you have to, or that you've got an extrinsic thing, you know, objective interior and manual and so forth, but who you are on the ocean.
Why do I row?
When you finish, can you let me
know? Oh, when I write my book, I'll let you know
how that goes.
Yeah. Yeah. I'll ponder that on the ocean.
Perhaps that's the case.
Yeah. I think that's the thing, is I've actually struggled quite a lot with trying to explain the motivation behind it, as to why keep going, or why did you get to this point? Why are you rowing, if someone was to ask you? And trying to explain it. I think it's because your motivations and the motivators do shift depending on where your mind is sitting and what your driver is.
I don't doubt at all that experience is important. I don't doubt anything that's going on, because I know, because of the work I've done over the years, I think I know why you do it. But I'm kind of really curious about how you understand what Cameron's talking about in relation to the nature of what you do.
Yeah. I think perhaps because a lot of the work that Cameron's done is more, I've found in our discussions, more about the peak performance. I've found it hard to, in some way, to relate to my experience, because it is so long-term. I don't need to have optimal flow for 4 months.
You can't do it.
So I think that's where I'm interested to see how that goes with the type of work, where I think more of the athletes he's worked with are performance-based outcomes, where mine is more survival-based outcome. So how you probably maybe stay up at that optimal performance, and having less dips, or having dips maybe not as deep, is probably perhaps more the way of applying it. So I will be thinking on that. I have thought about that quite a bit, of how it does work. Mm-hmm. Any response to
that? So Heather, Cameron took us through all the expensive bits for sponsors, and you've got some names painted or applied to the side of the boat. Would you like to tell us a bit more about the sort of the support, the financial support, the sponsorship that you are hoping for, and the ways that people can support you?
So there is a GoFundMe page, so any amount of sponsorship. So the sponsorship part goes to the cost for the trip. As Stephen's pointed out, you can get your name on the boat, and that's as a stowaway, so that's $250 or more from an individual when you get your name on the boat. And if it's a company, there's options as well to have the company logo on that. And if you go onto the Pacific Giants website, there's different tiers for sponsorships and benefits of coming off from that, of the exposure from the trip, for different levels of support. So the link to that is also on the website. If you just go to sponsor now, you'll end up on that GoFundMe page. Any other questions?
Heather, is there one thing that you're ready
for
any other?
One of the common ailments is that you can get boils on your bottom. That's probably the one that I'm aware it's coming, and I don't think you can really do too much about it.
Write a poem about it.
Yes, I could mentally have that, might not take me there, but yes, that's probably the thing that I'm...
Rhyming couplets.
Conscious of, but yes, until you've rode for 3 weeks and then you start to see the results of it. Yeah. So that's one thing I'm not looking forward to.
And there's no way of avoiding that?
Seem to be. Yeah. There's different options, techniques that people use of what you can do, creams and pads for your seat and materials of shorts and stuff, but I have yet to hear someone say that they have avoided it.
Will your routine be controlled by daylight or nighttime hours depending on weather conditions?
Probably the wind, actually. Yeah, the weather conditions are probably going to control it more, because I found here, just with the strong easterlies, that kills the morning, and so it's noon by the time you can even get rowing if you're wanting to head west. So then you have to wait, and then may as well row into the night and then sleep in, because I can't move until about 11 the next day. So I found it to be weather conditions more than the light. Yeah.
And when you're not rowing, you put out the anchor?
Yes, so I have a parachute anchor that goes out the back. So that one, you have to take the rudder off in order to put that out. So I usually only put it out once a day unless I'm being blown in the opposite direction, because it ends up being a sort of a 20-minute hassle when you're hanging at the back of the boat, hopefully not getting too wet as you're doing it. Yeah. So that one's sort of a commitment. All right, I'm going to be on it for at least 4 hours. Yeah. So I'll probably end up doing 4 days and then have a proper sleep, whereas if you're in a team, they seem to be 2 hours on, 2 hours off. But they're never putting out a sea anchor unless it's storming.
You've chosen to go when? In April?
Yes.
And the reason is?
Wanting to be done by the hurricane season is the name. So, yeah. I don't want to be there when there's hurricane. So, I'd want to be done by August. Yep, so if you backtrack, you end up in April. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Simpler question than my previous one. I went and had a look at your boat this afternoon, and the first thing that struck me were the pink shoes.
Oh,
and
yes.
But because of where they were, and now I gather from what some of your early comments that boat originally was rowed by two people.
Mm-hmm.
When I first looked at it, I wondered, do you shift positions in different conditions? Or you always stay in the rear?
I think the only benefit of rowing in the bow position, so
yeah,
not where the sheets are,
yeah,
is in a really strong crosswind, you can have a bit more weight so it digs in so that it's not being blown as much. But the reason that you mostly sit in that one position is because that's where the rudder is. So you can control the direction. Yeah, so the right foot plate actually just turns the rudder. So that's the main reason why they're there. And they're pink because they were on clearance. Any other questions? All right, well, thank you so much for coming to listen and for your support in it. This is just the beginning, I feel. I have no idea what's going to happen next. My hope is that I make it farther than the 2 weeks getting out, and the next time that I can speak to you, I can tell you how it went and the experiences of it, whether boils come and how they come, etc.
No photos.
There were some horrific photos in one of the documentaries, if you ever do find it, of the two of when he goes. Yeah, after that, you think, well, if they can do it, anyone can do it. So thank you very much. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I remember my mother.